It gives me immense pleasure to extend a very warm welcome to all on behalf of the Commerce Association, Department of Commerce, Shaheed Bhagat Singh College. We have clubbed together on this digital platform for our second webinar on UGC regulations on academic integrity and ethics with a brief demo on Turnitin software plagiarism detection tool. The Commerce Association extends a heartiest welcome to our Honorable Principal Dr. Anil Sardana, our teacher in charge Dr. Kalpana Gupta, our convener Ms. Aarti Saini, and our session moderator Dr. Nisha Gupta. And of course, our very eminent speaker, Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati. Let me now introduce you to our speaker, Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati. With a PhD in Library and Information Science, Dr. Pooja has an experience of 20 years working with highly esteemed and regarded institutions such as UNICEF, British Council, DeLent, and Council for Social Development. She has authored 3 books, 2 of which were published by ISI Global, an international publisher based in the USA. She is also credited with organizing a national-level seminar on the theme Building Digital India, from the library point of view. She's a very active resource person and library professional with several reputed organizations and profession bodies. She's highly acclaimed for kicking off the Digital Information Management course under the aegis of the Center for Skill Development of the College. Without further ado, I invite Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati to share her insights on the topic.
So, now, ethics. Ethics, not necessarily we'll always say that academic integrity is always to do something with ethical or moral code. Not necessarily. Because I have been mentioning this again and again, sometimes we are committing mistakes out of ignorance. We are not aware of the facts that we are required to do this. For instance, if we are writing a paper, we may pick up a definition from somewhere and we may write it as it is. But we need to know that whenever we are picking even a definition from somewhere, we need to put the definition within quotes and we need to cite the source from where we have picked up the definition. If we are picking up a picture, a table, a music audio, we need to acknowledge that source also. So sometimes we are committing some mistakes unintentionally that has nothing to do with our ethics. That is why higher educational institutions are paying great attention on building up the skills which I was mentioning, the important skills of critical thinking, the important skills of argumentation, the important skill of how to cite correctly, the important skill of how to correctly, and the important skill of how to use grammar and vocabulary correctly. So, because now we have been discussing that research is so significant, it has got a huge value in determining the position, the international ranking of an institution. So, it has become all the more essential for us to understand the concept of plagiarism threadbare. It has become all the more essential for us to understand the concept of plagiarism because if unintentionally we will be committing any kind of mistake, it would fall back on us and it would fall back on our institution. So, what is the literal meaning of plagiarism? The literal meaning of plagiarism is whenever we are using someone's ideas or someone's words and are not giving due credit or acknowledgement to his idea or to his words, then it would be considered as stealing, theft. Why it would be considered as theft? Because that is his intellectual property and we are not supposed to steal anyone's property. That is intellectual property. If we are picking up some ideas from his intellectual property or from any source, we need to acknowledge that. Otherwise, it would be considered as a stealing process. So, if you are doing it, and that too, if you are doing it deliberately, you are using and without taking the source, without taking permission of that author, without giving him due credit, then all the more, it would become a case of a criminal kind of case. So, and when it would become a fraud kind of thing, when you are doing some research and picking up the data set, the complete data set from the previous literature, which is already there in the existing pool, and the findings, test methods, everything you are copying over there, you are not contributing anything in that. And you are portraying as if that is your own data set. These tests have been performed by you and these are the results on the basis of this data set. That is called as fraud. That is not plagiarism, that is fraud. And because it involves stealing as well as you are also lying that this survey has been done by me and these are my survey results and these are the statistical measures, these are the methodologies which have been followed to arrive at these results. So this is a complete kind of stealing and lying and which would end up in a fraud kind of thing. So there are different forms of plagiarisms which are taking place. It may be literal copying pasting, which we may call cloning. Exactly, you will be copying something and exactly reproducing in your content. That is literal copying. Or paraphrasing. What does it mean, paraphrasing? Whenever you are reading something and finding it relevant, you are picking up that idea and trying to rephrase it in your own language because you want your readers to understand it in a better way. You are thinking, let me rephrase it like this and let me cite an example to support this so that my reader should understand it properly. You are doing a good thing, but over there you should quote the source that I have picked up this idea from this source and now I am rephrasing it in my own language. This part I have already discussed that if you are picking up some drawing, some stats, music, then also you need to acknowledge the source from where you have picked it up. So these are the major prevalent forms of plagiarism which are being observed in documents. Cloning, I have already discussed, copying and pasting without making any editing in that. Paraphrasing, whenever you are using anyone else's idea without giving credit, find and replace. Sometimes what you are doing, you are picking up something and very smartly you are replacing the keywords with the synonyms. So as to portray as if that is your own creation because you have changed the language of the content. And then remix. You are picking up the content from various sources and then trying to paraphrase in your own language just to give a feel that this is your own content. And then recycling. What is recycling? Recycling is that when you are picking up a old publication and trying to portray it as your own publication. And sometimes you are picking up an idea from your own publication. That is, you have published a publication and you are using that idea. That idea is no more original idea. That idea has already been contributed in the knowledge pool. And secondly, you have got it published. When the idea has already been published, it has become the intellectual property of that journal or book in which that idea has already been published. So when you're taking your own idea from a published source, you need to acknowledge that also because that is no longer your intellectual property. That has become intellectual property of that particular journal and particular book wherever that text has been published. Then mashup. Whenever you are copying words or ideas from someone else's work and trying to mix up those and not giving credit to any one of them. So this kind of activity is known as mashup plagiarism. And sometimes what you are doing, you are citing the source, but very smartly you are changing the bibliographic details or you are changing this address of the source so that whenever the reader would go over there, he'll not be able to find the source. Whenever he'll be clicking that source, it would show error. So that is also a wrong way. You should give your citations properly so that if anybody would like to refer to those documents which you have cited within your text and which you are giving a reference list at the end of your document, they'll be able to access them. So you should give proper kind of citations. You should not do intentionally or unintentionally. It would also be considered as plagiarism. Then aggregator. What does it mean, aggregator? Sometimes what we are doing, we are picking up a concept and what we are trying to do, we are scanning the literature related to that concept and whatever relevant things are there, we are compiling them. We are compiling them and producing a document and we are thinking that we are doing a great job. No, that is just aggregation of information. Whatever information is already there in the information pool, you are just digging that up. You are just compiling it and producing it. So you are just aggregating the information. What is the new concept? What is the new dimension which has been added to the existing phenomenon or existing concept? So something, it might be a minor contribution, but a new contribution, an innovative contribution should be there. Then only it would be considered research. Otherwise, it would be considered as just an aggregation of knowledge, and this aggregation of already existing information would also be considered as plagiarism. So whenever you are reusing the existing published paper, but you are trying to, it is already there in the published literature, you are picking up that journal from the published literature and submitting it in another journal, because you are thinking that they will get to know that it has already been published. So this is plagiarism. And if you are copying, reproducing your work without giving proper reference to that work, this is your own work. If you are quoting your own work without giving proper reference to that work, this is also plagiarism, and this plagiarism will be known as self-plagiarism. Paraphrasing exists text of others and present it. Okay. So if you are paraphrasing text or ideas in your own words and not giving credit from where you have picked up this idea, then also it would be considered plagiarism. Using, copying so many words. Yes, some of the documents are entirely based upon a single document. If you are, you have studied a report and you are finding that this report has got major information which I would like to use in my document, no problems at all. If you give due acknowledgement to that report, if you have accessed just one document for your, so you give due credit to them, that majority of research is being undertaken after referring to this report. So due credit has to be given and a new dimension has to be given. Then only it would be considered that it is your research. And last but not the least, if you're asking someone else, some prominent person whom you know and you are very friendly with him or her, and if you'll be asking him or her to you write for me, I'll be publishing in my name, that is also plagiarism. So now after even higher educational institutions are also realizing that there is a dire need to promote the culture of academic integrity, because they really want to attain higher levels of excellence, and for that they know qualitative research and higher levels of academic integrity within their research community is very much required. So they really want to build up academic integrity skill in their researchers. For that, they have started laying down academic integrity policy. Recently in June in 2018, UGC has also enacted regulations which are dealing with prevention of plagiarism and which are dealing with promotion of academic integrity. We will be going through the main takeaways of that policy, because we have to work within those guidelines and regulations. See, whenever you are supposed to learn all these ethics, you are supposed to know all these guidelines and regulations. For example, I'm just giving you a simple example. If I need to drive on a busy road, I really need to understand the traffic rules. If I'll go on road and a traffic police will ask me that you have violated some rule, I can't say, oh, I don't know, these are the rules. So in the same manner, if you are publishing something, you are supposed to know all these rules and regulations as a responsible researcher. So you really want to understand, you really need to understand that these are the ethics which I need to know before pursuing my research. You cannot escape by saying, I was not aware of these things. Like if I go on road, I cannot escape by saying, oh, I was not aware of these things. These are the traffic rules. And secondly, the traffic cop would be asking me, show me your driving license, whether you have cleared the driving test by one of the driving schools. So in the same manner, whenever you are giving your manuscript for publication, please pay attention on this, what I am trying to tell. If you are submitting your manuscript for getting it published either in a journal or a book, kindly get it plagiarism detection tool. That plagiarism detection tool would take out a similarity report. That similarity report is just like your driving license. That similarity report is an evidence that you got it scanned, and now the similarity index is permissible, justifiable, so it is good to go. It is good to go for publication. So these two things, you cannot escape by saying, no, I was not aware that I have to mention all these things, whatever, even a minor thing, if I'm picking from some source, I need to acknowledge that, I need to cite that, I was not aware that I need to run my publication when it is in preprint stage through a plagiarism detection software. You need to know all these things, because if I need to drive, I need to know the traffic rules. I need to carry my driving license all the time. So in the same manner, if you really want to pursue research, and that too responsible research, which would be termed as qualitative research, which would in fact enhance your esteem, which you want really should bring good name to you, then you need to know these ethics, and you need to carry that similarity report, and you need to have that similarity report in your hand in pre-print period. Once your document would get published, you won't be able to do anything about it. The damage has already been done. So it is always advisable to understand, with the help of a plagiarism tool, have the similarity report in your hand, and then only submit it for publication. So for apprising all these things, these policies are being laid down by higher educational institutions, and they are also advising their academicians to use tools. Okay, so this is the policy. Yeah, these regulations are named by what is the title of these regulations? The title of these regulations are Promotion of Academic Integrity and Prevention of Plagiarism in Higher Educational Institutions Regulations 2018. And when did just a minute. And when this regulation has come into effect, this regulation came on July 23rd, 2018. So now we'll discuss what all has been covered in this policy. See, this is the significance of research ethics. So in this context, higher educational institutions are now laying down guidelines and regulations and advising their academicians and researchers to please work within these framework of these guidelines. So these guidelines are uniformly applicable to each and every stakeholder of the university, be it students, be it faculty, researchers, staff, even non-teaching staff, if they are pursuing any kind of research, they are also covered under these regulations. And irrespective of their capacity, whether they are regular, ad hoc, guest, temporary, visiting, they have to work within these regulations and guidelines. And how academic integrity is being defined in these regulations, this is the definition which they have given in their regulation. You may read it from here. It is the intellectual honesty in proposing, performing, and reporting any activity which leads to the creation of intellectual property. So these are some of the objectives, key objectives, which were kept in mind while framing this policy or guidelines. So they have demarcated some core areas where they have declared that they are zero tolerance zone. Like if I am living in Dwarka, there is no shop around my house because it is a zero tolerance area. Over here, no private shop is allowed in residential areas. The same way, I'm just giving you a literal example, the way I was giving an example for driving. So in the same manner, UGC has categorically stated that these are the areas which I have given in red color: abstract, summary, hypothesis, observations, results, conclusions, and recommendations. These seven areas, they should not have any kind of similarities. They should be completely free from similarity index. They should be your original thing, because they are the areas which are carrying the essence of your research. The essence of your research. So they should not carry the previous literature things. They should be original, your own thing. And if at all you are in, including something and picking up something, it should not be more than 14 words, 14 words. It should not be more than 14 words in continuation. Okay, in these areas. So these areas are no tolerance zone, zero tolerance zone. Okay. And then again, I'm trying to highlight this. So these seven areas are zero tolerance areas. So you cannot, no document would be allowed to get published if they have got similarities in these seven pertinent areas, which are carrying the essence of the research work. Now, there is a misconception, but there are some areas where similarities are allowed. Which are these areas? Like citations, bibliographies, literature surveys. Over there, they are justified and they are unavoidable similarities. You cannot avoid them. You have to produce those things over there. So they are unavoidable and justifiable similarities. And there is a misconception that similarity report is a plagiarism report. And if there are too many similarities in a document, that is a plagiarized report, plagiarized document. No, not at all. It is not necessarily always the case like this. It might be possible that that document might be having too many similarities because that document is based on too many studies and the existing literature, but towards the end, it has given a new dimension to that particular topic or to that particular concept. So it is not necessary that the similarity report is your plagiarism report. So when we'll be going towards Turnitin, we'll be learning that whatever report the Turnitin is generating, that is similarity report. That has nothing to do with plagiarism. So manual intervention in that report is very much required. Manual intervention means that is, see, it's computer. If you are giving address of an institution, so address of an institution would remain constant every time. You cannot do anything about it. If you are quoting address of an institution, it would say, okay, this person has taken address from this website. But that is an unavoidable similarity. That is quite justifiable. So when you will be manually scanning that document similarity report, you will get to know, okay, this the similarity is very genuine. So you will exclude that source. You will exclude that source. If that thing, if some author has given something in quotes and cited that, if I have picked up that this text from this source, in that case also, you will exclude that source. That author has given due acknowledgement to source. So this similarity has got no relevance. If the bibliography is getting included in your similarity report, you will exclude that bibliography. This is also justifiable and unavoidable similarity. So when manually you'll intervene in that similarity report, you'll manually filter out the justifiable similarities, then you will come across the actual similarity index of your report. And if that actual similarity index is in permissible limit, then your document will not be called as a plagiarized document. If the similarities are crossing beyond the permissible limit, then only it would be considered plagiarized document. We'll be talking about it in our latest slides. So what is this? I have already covered how you will be excluding the similarity. You will be excluding the similarities, all quoted work. If it has quoted with due credit to the source, then you will be excluding that. All references, bibliography, table of content, preface, acknowledgement, they will have some kind of similarity that is unavoidable and justifiable. You will generic terms, generic definitions, laws, standards, symbols, they'll always remain same. I cannot change any ordinance. I cannot change any law, rule. So whenever I'll be quoting that law, rule, I will be quoting it as it is. So these are justifiable similarities, which are to be excluded, which are to be excluded whenever you will be finalizing your similarity report. And on the basis of that, you will be analyzing whether the similarities which are there are in the permissible limit or they are crossing the permissible limits. So as per this report, as per these guidelines, which are being laid down by UGC in June 2018, these are the four levels. Okay, starting from level 0 to level 3. Level 0 states, if your document is having similarities up to 10%, they are minor similarities. You don't have to worry about that. because they are justifiable. If you are at level one, so level one would comprise of documents having similarities between 10 to 40%, and in case of level two, they are 40 to 60%, and level three is the highest level where the similarities in your document will be above 60%. So these are the four levels which are being defined by these regulations. So what are the penalties the higher educational institutions may impose on you if they are finding your document falling in any of these levels? These penalties I'm quoting for students. The students who are pursuing MPhil or PhD, so if they'll be submitting their dissertation thesis, and if their dissertation would fall in level zero, then there would be no penalty. If their dissertation would be falling in level one, such student shall be asked to submit a revised script within a stipulated time period not exceeding 6 months. He'll be given a chance, you revise your script and resubmit it, and that too within a stipulated time period, and which would not exceed more than 6 months. Then if your document is falling in level two, that means that student would be debarred for submitting a revised script because the similarity index is quite high. And he will be asked to, and for how long he'll be debarred for that? He'll be debarred for submitting the fresh copy for a period of 1 year. And in the extreme case, that is level three, the registration of that student will be cancelled. But this is the extreme case. So for authors, like for us, if we are authoring a paper, research paper for a publication, for a journal or for a book, so what are the penalties we may have to face if we not get our document scanned? So if we are at level zero, we are in safe zone. If we are at level one, we'll be asked to withdraw our manuscript. And if we are at level two, we'll be asked to withdraw our manuscript. And we'll also be denied to have our 1 annual increment. And in addition to this, you will not be allowed to supervise any of your master's students or scholar for a period of 2 years. And if you are unfortunately falling in the extreme category, that is level three, then you will be asked to withdraw your manuscript. You will be denied 2 annual increments, and you will be also not be allowed to supervise any of your students, scholars, research scholars for a period of 3 years. So these are the penalties you may have to face if you will not get your document scanned, and if you will not apprise yourself with the research ethics. Like you have to paraphrase it properly. And the basic principle which you need to learn is whatever, even if two sentences, if you are picking up from any source, you just cite them. You just give due acknowledgement to them. And if you are paraphrasing also, then also give due acknowledgement to them. And the seven areas, those seven core areas should be your original thing. And the other areas are understandable, justifiable. So those areas may have good amount of similarities, but those seven core areas should be entirely free from similarities. At the most, you can have 14 words in continuation in those seven areas. So if you it has been found that you are repeating this thing repeatedly, your documents are reporting good amount of similarity, so in that case, what higher educational institution can do? That higher educational can give you a punishment one level higher than whatever kind of similarity is being observed in your document. So if the similarity in my document is of level one, but this is second time which has been reported, so I will be given the punishment which is there for level two, a level higher than that. And when I'll be repeating this offense three times, then disciplinary action might be taken, and this disciplinary action might be of such a serious nature, like suspension and termination as per the service rule. Then penalty in case where the benefit, there are cases where the benefit for that particular publication has already been taken, the credit has already been taken, but later on it has come to notice, it has been brought to our notice that no, the document, that document was a plagiarized one. In that case also, the credit or the any kind of benefit that has been given, that may be withdrawn on the approval by the approval of the head of the institution. And if there is any complaint of plagiarism, again the head of the institution, in all these cases, who will be taking the final decision? Head of the institution will be taking the final decision. In my subsequent slide, I'll be showing you this regulation has also proposed a constitution of an academic integrity panel who will be taking care of all the plagiarism complaints. I'll be showing you what is the composition of this, that panel, but always that panel will be headed by the head of the institution. And if a complaint would come against head of the institution, then what would be the case? Then in that case, he will also be if he is the head of the institution, then also he will also be governed by these regulations. The proper action would be taken by the controlling authority of the higher educational institution against head of the institution also. So though these regulations have come into force from the date of their notification, that is 23rd of July or whatever date is there, 23rd of July I think 2018, but this notification would take into account all the publications published prior to that date also. Okay. So I was talking about this panel. So this regulation has proposed to constitute an institutional academic integrity panel for addressing the complaints with respect to plagiarism. So there should be a committee or a panel which would be addressing these complaints, which would be assessing whether this complaint is valid, it has got some ground. So who are the members who will be formulating this panel? Chairman would be pro VC, either slash means either of them. Pro VC, dean, senior academician of the higher educational institution, he'll be chairing this. Either of these will be chairing this panel, and the members will be, these three would be the members. Who are these three persons? Who's who? They are who's who of higher educational institutions, senior academician, other than the chairman, to be nominated by the head of the higher educational institution, other than the chairman. One member nominated by the head of the higher educational institution from outside the higher educational institution. So see, for if I'll consider it in our college case, so pro VC, dean, senior academician, then our principal of the college will be nominating one person other than chairman of the college, and then one member nominated by head of the, then again principal would be nominating someone outside from our college, and a person well versed with anti-plagiarism tools who will be able to analyze, who will be able to assess whether the complaint has got some weightage or not. That document would be scanned through this anti-plagiarism tool. So the in this panel, a person should be there having knowledge of the anti-plagiarism tool. So this is all about panel. And why this panel is being constituted? This panel is being constituted to address the complaints related to plagiarism. Okay. And the panel will be taking come into action not only on getting complaints, it can take action on suo motu on its own also. If it will come to know, okay, though I would like to check whether these documents are genuine or not, so these kinds of cases may be investigated by IAIP on its own also. So now before moving to plagiarism detection tool, before getting into application, I would like to show you some of the recent and very prominent cases of plagiarism which came in limelight. And I'm just giving you an example that these are the kind of serious consequences one may have to face. These are the serious kind of consequences one may have to face if we'll come into trap of this plagiarism, intentionally or unintentionally. Repeatedly, I have been saying that many a times we are committing these mistakes unintentionally because we are not unaware of the thing. But if you really want to pursue responsible research, you need to understand all these things. You need to understand that citations are important. You need to understand that quoting them and giving proper citations, paraphrasing correctly, everything you need to know. You cannot escape by saying that I was not aware of these facts, because otherwise you'll end up into hassles like this. Like, this is a well-known person, and she was in news because of this plagiarism case. And you'll be surprised to know, many of you might be knowing, though this case, I'm quoting this, please, this case was quashed by High Court. This case was quashed by High Court, but he went through this trauma because of a plagiarism complaint against him. Our ex-Delhi University vice chancellor went through this trauma because of this plagiarism complaint, though the case was quashed by High Court. So whatever instances, whatever examples I am giving, I am just giving those examples just to highlight that even prominent persons can end up like this. So we need to be highly careful. So I am not at all authorized to comment whether these complaints are genuine or whatever, whether they are carrying any kind of facts or not. But they were in limelight, they were in news. So I am just highlighting that in them. Springer, as all of you know, is a well-established publisher. They also withdrew an article by three Indian scientists, and that too, they withdrew that article, that too after 14 years of its publication. 14 years of its publication, and at that time when that article got published, the lead author, the primary author, A. Banerjee, was a PhD candidate with a premium institution, National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research. And two co-authors were also there. Springer withdrew that article after 14 years when they found that was having some plagiarized content. So like this, Rajasthan University, three teachers were found. Management Development Institution, it is one of the well-known institutions, sought-after institution for pursuing management education, which is there in Gurgaon. Even it was in news that they suspended one professor for Plagiarism Act. And JNU was also in news for this such kind of incident. Then Chetan Bhagat, he is known for his light reading novels, and he was also in limelight because of plagiarism. IIM, institutions of national importance. So IIM is whatever face India is saving, that is saving because of national institutions of national importance. Like last time we were discussing QS survey report. So even IIM was in limelight because of this plagiarism case. Then this is again against one of the VCs, plagiarism case against one of the VCs, like our Pondicherry University VC. So I have just included those slides just to give you a glimpse that these are the serious kind of consequences you may have to face if you will not be careful. So now these are some of the tools which are being used to scan your document before getting it published. What these tools would be doing, these tools have got huge repository. Turnitin today we'll be talking about Turnitin. Turnitin is having a repository of three kinds of documents. It has indexed various websites, it has various patients, and it has also indexed various assignments of students. And this software is applicable to students as well as to faculty members and scholars. So Turnitin is one of them, which is widely being used across the world, and it is 22 years old software. And Turnitin has got two, one is iAuthenticate and another one is Turnitin. What is the difference between iAuthenticate and Turnitin? iAuthenticate is exclusively for authors, faculty members. It has nothing to do with students' assignments. where it is being used? It is mostly used by publishers. All the prominent publishers of journals are having this software at them. Whenever you are submitting your manuscript for getting it published in that particular journal, they are not publishing it right away. They are getting it reviewed from the peers, and then for plagiarism check, they are getting it scanned with the help of this software, with the help of this tool. And the name of this tool is iAuthenticate. Some of the institutions are also buying iAuthenticate as compared to Turnitin. Reason being, Turnitin is a broader platform. If you want to integrate your students also into this activity, you want that your students should also submit their assignments through this tool, then what they'll be doing? Once they'll be submitting their assignment, they'll be able to generate an originality report of that assignment. How original is my assignment? Wherever the sources are, wherever the content of your text is matching with the content in other sources which are indexed in this repository, it would highlight, see, this content you have taken from this source, this content you have taken from this source. So the student would be able to know, okay, now I need to refine further. I need to bring the similarity index down. And in the same manner, his classmates or her classmates would be able to assess his assignment, because they'll also be able to access his assignment, and they will be evaluating at their end, you see, you have not covered this aspect in your assignment. So they'll be giving their reviews and their observations and comments. And finally, the instructor would be evaluating the assignments of those students online only. And then he'll be able to give annotations, like in last time we were mentioning in Mendeley, annotation facility is there. In the same manner, in Turnitin, if the instructor or faculty member is evaluating the assignment of a student in online mode, then he'll be able to give remarks online, and he'll be giving the grades, marks online, and the student will get to know that I have got this much marks in this particular assignment. These are the three things which can be done with respect to students' assignments, but we'll not go into students' thing. Okay, we'll be going in authors' thing only. So for authors' thing, if you don't want to integrate students in your software, then I would say iAuthenticate is the good option for procuring for your institution, because in that case, all authors, all faculty members who will for its publication, they'll first submit this article through, they'll get it scanned through this tool, and when the similarity report will come, they will assess it manually, they will scan it, and whatever exclusions are possible, they will exclude it, and those exclusions, you will make those exclusions in sync with, I'm again repeating, you will make those exclusions not on your own. You will make those exclusions in sync with these regulations. Like what these regulations are saying? These regulations are saying you can exclude bibliography. You can exclude quotes. You can exclude 14 words continuity similarity from your thing. If in continuation 14, you can exclude them. So these exclusions you can make because your university has permitted that you can make these exclusions. So whenever you will be making manual intervention in your similarity report, you will make these exclusions so that the similarity index will come down. So these are the two products of Turnitin only, iAuthenticate and Turnitin Feedback Studio. The student version is known as Turnitin Feedback Studio. And the authors and researchers and faculty members version is known as iAuthenticate. And there are other tools which are also quite popular. They are Urkund, Open Access, Drillbit. So, Turnitin, I have already explained it, that it is widely being used by educational institutions across the world. And the kind of similarity report, it is the kind of similarity report being generated by Turnitin is unmatchable. And this also I have covered, that there are two versions. One is exclusively for researchers and another one is for student assignment papers. And the major functions which Turnitin is performing is plagiarism check. In fact, we should call it similarity check. We should not call it as plagiarism check, because plagiarism, we'll be ascertaining it after manual intervention. Then students' assignments, we'll be checking it for originality. The instructor would be able to grade the student, and even the peers would be able to grade the read his friend. So what kind of coverage is there in Turnitin? The repository is having three kinds of documents. This also I have explained: web pages, student assignments, and publications. So this is the main purpose of the Turnitin software. This I have already explained, that we should not have this kind of misconception that similarity report is plagiarism report. It is quite possible that the software has generated similarity report with 50% similarities, and you will be able to bring it down to 20%. It is quite possible, and that too within in lines, in sync with the UGC guidelines. I'll be showing you how. So this, whatever similarity report would come, if it would display your report in different kinds of colors. If the report which is getting generated is in green color, it means the similarity is in the range of 1 to 24%. That is why the report is in green color. And if the similarity is in between 25 to 49%, then the report would be in yellow color. And if it is between 50 to 74%, then the report would be in orange color, and above 74% it would be red. The colors are self-explanatory. Green means you are safe. Yellow means you are moving towards danger zone. Orange means you have already reached, almost reached, and red means, oh my god, it is full of similarities. So what is the basic thing which you should remember so as to avoid plagiarism, that I have been telling you again and again? Please, please, please cite everything. Cite everything. Whatever you are using for reproducing your producing your content or your paper, please cite. Okay. And once again, I would like to revise this thing. These are the no tolerance, zero tolerance areas. Please do not use any copy paste material, at least in these areas, because these areas. Which are written in a little big font, these areas are still understandable, and the similarities occurring in these areas are unavoidable. Okay, so they are justifiable, but these are your core areas of paper. These are your core areas. They are carrying the essence of your paper, the originality of their paper, your paper. So these areas should not be having any kind of similarity. They are non-core areas. Okay, and then you should be quite friendly with the tools which are managing references, because whenever you are performing your literature search, you are referring to n number of documents and you are picking up ideas from many of them. So you should be equipped with a reference management tool. That is why we have planned this series like this. We have covered various aspects of qualitative literature, qualitative research, along with the tools which are being used to measure the various parameters, and the tools which are being used to manage references. So you kindly do that. You please do that so as to avoid any kind of confusion. These three things are important to avoid. These three things are important, very, very important if you really want to avoid plagiarism. First, whatever thing you are taking from anywhere, please cite it within your text. Please cite it within your text and give a proper reference at the end of your document. And if you are just scanning many documents, then it is always advised to give a bibliography of the entire material which you have scanned during your course of study. So these are the formats. They are standards. We have already discussed them in our last Mendeley session, that these are the standards which are to be followed while giving references. Okay. So now I'm sure that you people have got better understanding of plagiarism. So with this, my theory part is over. So, okay, this is my email ID. If anyone of you would like to contact me, this is my email ID. So now we'll quickly get into the application. So this is our application. Okay. This is our application. And how we'll be going to it? We'll be going to Turnitin.com, www.turnitin.com. This is our login. Okay. this again, like Scoopers and like Scoopers, it is also subscription-based tool. Subscription-based tool. Your institution has to subscribe it. Individual subscriptions are not allowed. Okay, you cannot subscribe it individually. So South Campus is subscribing to it, and I am using this login details of South Campus only. Our college is not subscribing to Turnitin, but many a times whenever faculty members are requesting for plagiarism report, we are getting it done with the help of South Campus because our college is under South Campus. So when you'll open, the homepage would look like this. Okay, and these are assignments, these are classes. Okay, under each class there would be some papers submitted by students, which faculty members would be evaluating those papers, would be awarding grades to those assignments, like that. And the originality reports of those assignments would also come. Now I have also created a folder over here, because every time you need to create a folder over here. So I have created a folder with the name of our college, SBSC. Okay, now it is showing this folder will be having documents pertaining to this college, SPSC. And now I'll go to this view. So last night I was just, for example sake, I was adding some reports. So I'll be showing you what I have added and how I'll be seeing. I've given for whenever you'll be submitting, I'll be showing you how you'll be submitting. Submitting is very easy. You just either you'll be going to quick submit from the main menu, or you may go to your respective folder. Like I have created my own folder. You can go over here, submit file. But these two functions are essential to learn. This is all about Turnitin. One thing you need to learn, that how to submit my document in Turnitin for getting it checked for plagiarization or for similarity. And the second thing, when the plagiarism report would come, you will be able to assess it and would like to exclude the similarity things which are in sync with the guidelines, so as to reduce its similarity. Okay, so what you'll be doing, once you'll be writing submit, it would be asking you choose file. So you may choose a file from your, say, for instance, I'll choose from my desktop. I have chosen this chapter 4. And if I'll write open like this, it will start attaching my file. Oh, now it is showing there is an error, but it would attach over here. Then it would ask me my name. So with what name you would like to attach this file. And if you can attach multiple files over here, and then can say upload all. Okay. And then your okay, so this the way you are attaching any file to email or to any platform. This is so simple. Just you go to submit file, choose the location of the file. Up, if you want to attach multiple files, give the name of the author. If somebody has forwarded you any file, then give the name of the authors as their name, because you're not the author of that file. And yes, one thing which you must remember while submitting your file is that an option would come. So you always select, do not deposit in repository. No repository. Always select no repository, because you just want to get it scanned, and on the basis of similarity report, you will be revising your paper, and again you will be submitting the revised version in this plagiarism tool. You'll be you are free to submit as many numbers of versions, as many versions as you want to get them scanned through this tool. But for that, you make it sure that you are not choosing that no repository option. If you'll submit it in repository, then it has got a huge repository. And once it would be indexed in that repository, next time whenever you'll be submitting that same paper, the similarity would enhance substantially. Why the similarity would enhance substantially? But because that paper is already there in repository. So now the paper which is being submitted by you, it is getting matched with that existing paper. So it is showing, oh my God, this paper is already there. So that is why it is always advisable whenever you are submitting, choose no repository option. So submitting is so simple and straightforward. After submission, see, this is the document. If you'll, this is the name who it's being submitted by author of this paper. This is the original file. If you click on this, it would show you how does the original file look like. Okay, and this is the ID which automatically Turnitin is giving to that paper. This is the ID. With this ID, the paper is being submitted, on which date this paper is being submitted. So I don't want to look at the original file. I just want to look at the similarity file. When the similarity file would appear on your screen, the matching would be displayed in different colors. See, these are the red buttons. This I'll make you understand. With the help of these buttons, you'll be able to exclude the similarities which are justifiable and unavoidable, so as to reduce your similarity index. See, it's showing 15% matching is there. For instance, this 2% matching is, see, it is in red color, it is in another shade of red, this is in purple color, this is in blue color, this is in green color. So all the sources are reflected in different colors, and the corresponding matching content, and the corresponding matching content is this content, is also getting reflected in the same color. If I am clicking this, it is saying C, address thing I was mentioning, na address, you can't do anything about it. Address would remain same. So you can very easily exclude this source, because unnecessarily it is increasing your similarity index by 2%. So now let me scan to another one. See, the another one is, the color is the same. The corresponding source is in the same color. And if you want to see the entire source, you just click over here. See, entire source it is showing, and the content which is getting matched with your content is just this one in real, this red one. It is showing from the entire content, the part which is matching your document is this one only, red one only. So this is also acceptable. So some words are used, some words are very similar words. If you are talking about online learning, you will talk about real time thing. So it is also not of a problem over here. Problem would be there if the entire paragraphs would be matching with the source with no additions, and if three lines are matching and then two, three lines are not matching, again three sentences are matching, it means smartly some things are being edited and reproduced from the source. But like address case, there is nothing to worry about. This also, there is nothing to worry about. Okay. So this I was saying, see, all the sources are reflected over here, and then you may scan there, and it is showing what kind of resources is. Most of them are internet source. Let me see whether publications are there or not. Most of them are internet source. No publication source it is reflected. No publication sources. If publication would be there, in place of internet source, it would be written as publication. Okay. And if student assignment, and there is a, whenever you'll be submitting, there would be an option to exclude assignments repository. You may exclude assignments repository because you are a faculty. You may do that. So I did that. That is why assignments are not coming over here. And most of them are internet resources. Like if I click over here, see, the it is showing me. And if I want to see the complete document, this, oh my God, publication has come. See, it is publication. Again, it is a publication. It is a publication. Four publications, five, six publications have come. So it is a publication. If I would like to refer to this, I will. Full text is not available. Okay, it is showing the full text of this document is not available. Never mind. I'll go to another publication. Many publications are also there. So this way you may scan and can assess that these documents, whether these exclusions are possible or not, and how you would be excluding them. I'll show you. Let me just go to this publication. Like this is showing publication. Let me see if I would. No, again, it is saying full sources, not full complete text. Is not there. Okay, now if I would like to exclude, how I will be excluding that? I need to press this over here. There is a window, exclude sources. Okay. When I'll be clicking that, enabling that, these boxes, check boxes would come. For instance, this, I was matching it with that address thing. I should exclude it. I should exclude it. I should exclude it. For, I'm just giving you an example. You'll be assessing them whether they are justifiable to exclude. Then you'll be excluding them. The moment you'll exclude them, it would ask you to generate a new report, and that report would come with less similarity index. And what are the generic changes which you are, you can make? See, since it is this tool is being subscribed by South Campus University of Delhi, they have already enabled these filters. Exclude codes. This is in sync with the guidelines regulations, UGC guidelines. The codes, you, if the some information is there in codes and it is similar to a source, you exclude that. You don't include it in similarity. So it is do that. Exclude bibliography. Exclude bibliography. And if 14 words in continuation are similar to a content appearing in any of the source, then we exclude that. 14 words are allowed as per the guidelines. So these things you may, if they are not enabled, if you are using this tool from somewhere else, go to this filter one. Whenever you'll be opening, how you will be, what I'm trying to show you, once the similarity report is being generated, you will go to that similarity report. How you'll go to that? You'll just click that. When you'll click that, that report will get displayed like this. In the right panel, these red buttons would come, and these red buttons would enable you to fiddle with your report. This would enable you to assess which are the sources which are showing matching content in your document, and then you'll be filtering them out. If it is not enabled, in this case it is enabled, if you will disable it, so it would increase the, and I will say apply changes, because just I'm just giving you an example. See, from 15% it has become 21%. From 15% it has become 21% because I have included bibliography. So, and though our guidelines are saying we should exclude bibliography, so in this case I'm saying apply changes, and if I'll click over here new report, the new report would get generated. So these are some of the things, buttons which you would be using to evaluate your report. The one of the pertinent button is filter and settings, and over here I would advise never use percentage thing. Reason being, you always use for words thing. Reason being, because if a document is having 4,000 words, if you'll write 1%, that in that case, 1% would be a good number. So it is always, you stick to the guidelines. Your exclusion should be in the guidelines. So these, as per the guidelines, these exclusions are permissible. So exclude them. And this is also optional setting, if multicolor highlighting. The document is getting highlighted in different colors just to make a difference in the different kind of sources. So you enable that. Now, this would show you all sources which are there. And this would show you percentage wise distribution. So what matching is there from which source. And this is, yes, what is this? These sources I have excluded. But later on, I'm finding, no, let me restore them. So you can restore them. Restore all. Okay. So now 16% it has come. So this is the way you may be able to refine your report. And now I would like to show you that how you'll be able to submit your report. Okay. These are the classes. And I was mentioning that I have created a folder exclusively for our college, that is Shaheed Bhagat Singh College. Evaluation is a very simple and straightforward, very simple task to do, that you will be able to do once you will be going through your similarity report. And the after exclusions, the whatever similarity report would come with a lower similarity index, that would be your final report. And if you have not deposited that report in your repository, you are free to submit the revised version of your report in this tool. And now I'll be teaching you, once you'll be into this homepage of this Turnitin software, this is showing all the classes which are there. And this has nothing to do with it. It has something to do with administrator. So being an instructor, an author, you will be using this button, quick submit. So once you'll be submitting that, see some of the reports which have recently been generated by this tool. Now you'll be submitting. Submit. Okay. Now see, that's what I was saying. Submit papers to no repository. Please remember this, no repository. And you are asking this, search the internet, whatever content I am depositing to this tool, search the internet, match it with the internet content, match it with the journals, periodicals, journals and publications. But I am saying don't match it with the student papers, because three kinds of documents are there. And then I will be saying submit. Then I would first, it was asking me which three categories you want to get them matched. So I have selected two out of three. And then it was asking me no repository. I have not deposited. I have asked the tool, please do not deposit my document in the repository. Then I'll be choosing file from here. And then I'll be clicking over here. What from wherever look, whatever location, I don't know why it is saying, but it is so easy. Then you'll be choosing it, you'll be filling up your names over here, upload all, and then this window would direct you to, let me just try once more. Yes, thank God. So, okay. So, yes, it's being loaded. Now, it's asking me my last name, asking me my first name and my title. And now I'll be, this way I have loaded my file. Now I'll be, I have chosen my file. Now I'll be uploading it. Now, what is it saying? Submit. Okay, once I'll submit it, it will direct me to the main page, and within 5-6 minutes, the originality report would come. Your submission completed successfully. See, now my submission is on the top of the list. My submission is on the top of the list. The original file is over here. The paper ID which is being given by this software is this, and the date of submission is 18th June 2020, but the similarity report hasn't come yet. The similarity report would come within, because it would take some time. It would take another 5-6 minutes, and then the similarity report would come over here. See, all these reports are in green color. Okay. So you, if they are in green color, they are in safe zone. If the report would come in yellow, orange, or red color, then you need to really need to intervene in the report manually, so as to see what exclusions can I made in lines with the guidelines, so that my similarity index should come down. So now after some time, the similarity report would come, then we'll be seeing what kind of similarity index this report is giving for the document which I have submitted over here. With this, I am over with my presentation, and these are the two pertinent things which you need to learn about Turnitin and research ethics. So with this, I would like to hand over the session to either to Arnav or to Aarti, and would be happy to take any queries or observations, if any, by any of the participants. And then we'll be coming back to this window and we'll be seeing what kind of report has been generated by this tool. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for such an insightful and enlightening session. With that, we come to the start of the question and answer session. I request Dr. Nisha Gupta, ma'am, to host this question and answer session and address any questions from the chat to Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati. Ma'am, I think Nisha Gupta, ma'am, isn't here at the moment, so I'll be addressing the questions.
Did you check her? Is she there? You can unmute her, I think.
I'll just check, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am is there.
Yeah, thank you. We'll now start with our question answer round. So the first question that is asked by Antariksha, mm-hmm. That is how to write introduction for thesis whether we should write our own language or opinion, or shall we refer any research for the same?
The core areas. I have already mentioned the core areas. You always try to original in your core areas. If you really want to mention any existing literature related to your topic, it is always advisable to use that reference in your literature survey. Okay, and if you really want to point out some basic thing or some basic phenomenon or definition or law in your introduction part, you are free to do that. But the only thing I would advise you to do that, you quote the source. You cite the source properly and give the reference of that source. But too many references are not at all advisable. You may give one or two in your introduction, and please enclose them within quotes, or if you are paraphrasing them, you give the source and give the proper citation.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay. One more question is asked. I think it is now answered that if paraphrasing is plagiarism, then what are the literature review based papers? How to write it? I think by just giving the acknowledgement to the two sources.
Paraphrasing, if you are literature review papers are there, then also you are adding your own ideas in them. You are adding your own interpretations in them. You are not just aggregating the information. If I am doing literature survey on some certain topic, I will not be reproducing the content as it is and would be asking the readers to assess it on their own. I will be making interpretations out of that. No? I will be trying to make them understand it in my own language. I'll be citing some examples. See, this law is stating that, and with the I'm giving you an example. With the help of this example, you'll be able to understand how this law is getting into force. So you need to have your own ideas. You need to club your own thinking with the existing literature also. So just sheer aggregation will not be counted as research. Sheer aggregation will not be counted as research. You need to add some new dimension or your own thoughts, your own ideas, your own interpretations on the basis of the existing literature. Then you will be able to write your literature-based article. You are free to do and whatever literature you are filtering out of the existing literature, you need to quote that. You need to cite that and give the proper listing of references in your references list. Okay.
Ma'am, from where we can get access to Turnitin software or open access sources? So for Turnitin, you have already mentioned that it should be like subscribed one.
No individual can subscribe it individually. Yeah. So you, your institution has to subscribe it. And being part of University of Delhi, we are very fortunate that South Campus is subscribing to it, and they have given us they have given their login ID and password to me. So we are able to access Turnitin. And you are asking me about open access resources. Open access resources are equally reliable. You can access qualitative information with the help of open access resources. But one thing I would like to highlight over here is that what is the commercial model? Why people are aggregating information on open portals? What they are getting out of it? Actually, they are giving you information free of cost, but they are taking money from the authors. Like if I would like to get something published and I'm not that well-known author, so I would approach an open forum. I have got a good article. I would like to get it published in an open forum. And one thing more, because I want to increase its visibility. In open forums, anybody can access anything without subscription. So visibility in open forums would automatically get enhanced. So if I would ask them to include my paper in their open repository, they would ask me to pay. So authors would be paying to submit their articles in open repository, but for users, it would be free. So this is the commercial angle. By this way, they are managing their business. Okay.
Next question is, ma'am, whether citation is sufficient enough or needs to get permission from the agency or author to avoid plagiarism?
Please repeat your question.
Whether citation is sufficient enough or needs to get the permission from the agency or author to avoid plagiarism?
See, if you are picking up a certain thing from a publication, from a source, citation would be enough. And if you are using an entire document, and if you are using a discovery, invention, patent kind of thing, then you need to seek permission of that particular person. If you are just picking up an idea, a concept, a phenomenon, the reference, the citing that source is enough. And if you are picking up the entire thing from somewhere, the entire invention, and that data set, see, so then in that case, if you are using someone else's data and someone else's finding to substantiate, to validate your study, in that case, you need to take permission of the concerned person. Without permission, you cannot use his or her work. So there is a difference. If you are taking some minute things, so citation is enough. If you are taking majority of the things from a person's work, in that case, you need to take permission.
The researcher is writing the review paper and compiling the previously done studies. And on the basis of the findings, he is suggesting the future directions. Will it consider plagiarism?
See, this I have already covered. If yeah. it is just sheer aggregation, you have not contributed anything new to it. See, a concept is there, online learning. Okay, if I am writing something on online learning and I am picking up all the pertinent things, all the available material in the existing literature, this is on online learning and not giving a new dimension. You need to give a new dimension to it. It should have a new flavor in it. Then only it would be considered as a research item. Otherwise, it would be considered as just compilation of things. Like you people are asking your students to follow this guide. That guide is not a teacher. That guide has just compiled the question answers. This is your guide. You may refer to this guide and then you'll be able to answer your questions in your exam. No, you are not supposed to create any guide. See, this is a guide on such and such topic. You are an author. You are supposed to give some input, some innovative ideas in the research pools. You are not supposed to produce guides. If you'll be producing guides, then it would be considered plagiarism only. Okay.
One more question. If by mistake the document content is saved in repository, so is there any option to undo it?
Yes, yes, there is an option to undo it. In that case, you need to remember that ID. I was showing you now, there is by this way you can see the original file, and this is the ID which is being given by this Turnitin tool. You just remember that ID. Whenever you are submitting that document, you just write down that ID. By a mistake, if you have selected that repository, you just write to Turnitin that we are subscribing to your tool, and by mistake I have added my document to repository and the ID of this document is this and this. I request you to kindly withdraw this document from that repository. Turnitin people would be doing that, but they'll be for doing that because they have got huge number of clientele, and then they'll be searching it with the help of that ID, and then they'll be withdrawing it finally. This is possible, but for that you have to remember the ID of the document. The title author would not work. Title author would not work. In that case, you need to provide document ID to Turnitin people. You need to write them. They'll be doing that. Okay.
One more. If suppose you have taken something from a paper which is already there in the Turnitin repository, but you have duly acknowledged it, will it still come under different colors?
Could you please repeat your question?
If we have taken something from a paper which is already there in the repository, but you have duly acknowledged it, will it still come under different colors?
No, if you have duly acknowledged it, and you have given it in quotes, or if you have rephrased it and the words are within 14 words limit, then it would not highlight it. And if you have the similarity of the content from that document is exceeding 14 words limit, then it would highlight it.
Okay.
then it would highlight it. The moment the 14 words limit would be over, this tool would start recognizing it as a similarity. That 15th word, 15 similar words are there. This document is matching 15 words with this source document. Then it can, in that case, it would be matching. So always keep in mind, if you are rephrasing it, so give the quote. So that is not a problem. And if you are producing it as it is, cloning it, so clone it up to the word limit of 14.
Okay. One more question by Mr. Mohan. Whether words highlighted less than 14 words, including some common words like current assets or is, so will it be counted in total similarity percentage?
Yes, yes. Word count means word count. It is not alphabets count, it is word count. The entire sentence comprising of 14 words, whatever. So if there are two sentences of 14 words, they once the 14 words would terminate over there at the end of the second sentence, after that it would say, till the 14th word it would say similarity, it would exclude. Once the 15th word, similar word would come, it would say it is a similarity because it is a machine. You may do that on your own. You may do that on your, you may exclude that manually, by manually intervening in that report. But machine, whatever directions, instructions engineers have given to the software, it would be doing like that only. It has got no resources. Okay. I hope I'm
That's
able to
all,
answer.
That's all, ma'am. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
With that, we come to an end of the question and answer session. I would now like Dr. Anil Kumar, the teacher in charge, to present a vote of thanks.
Please unmute, sir.
Anil, sir. I think Anil sir cannot hear us at the moment. I would request our convener, Dr. Aarti Saini, to present a vote of thanks.
Okay, respected principal, sir. Okay, Anil sir is there. Yeah. I think, okay, before you proceed, sir, let me just thank all the participants for the patient listening and showing trust in us. This is definitely a moment of honor for us. Like I'm seeing like 70 plus participants throughout the webinar. And thank you all for trusting us, the team of Commerce Association. So Anil sir, would you like to say something? We need to unmute, sir. This is 884211.
Unmute. Okay. Are you listening now? Is it okay?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. So let me just introduce Dr. Anil Kumar. He will be our teacher in charge for the next session. As Kalpana ma'am and Dr. Anil Sardana is not present over here, so he wanted to give the formal vote of thanks. Thank you, Anil sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Aarti. So I, Dr. Anil Kumar, on behalf of Department of Commerce, thanks the resource person of the day, Dr. Pooja Anand Gulati, for this wonderful, very well-organized, informative and nicely presented webinar on research, ethics and academic misconduct issues and strategies. Really, Pooja ji has thrown light on the most important part of research like ethics, plagiarism, its forms, levels, what to include in the research paper, what to exclude, penalties for offenses by including all important regulations and guidelines issued by the University Grants Commission, and also different tools to check the plagiarism in detail. Thank you very much, Pooja ji. And I am also thankful for our principal, Dr. Anil Sardana ji, without whose support, you know, this webinar could not have happened. And our teacher in charge, Dr. Kalpana Gupta, whose continuous support has made this webinar to happen. And I am also thankful to the convener for organizing such webinar, Dr. Ms. Aarti Saini, for putting our dedication to organize such a nicely organized webinar, back-to-back, webinar. It is third in the series, and the moderator for the day, Nisha Gupta, for wrapping up the questions in a very fantastic way. Thank you, Nisha, and the team, Commerce Association, especially Arnav, Anirban Bhattacharya, Ashita Taneja, and Kashi Sharoda. And I am also thankful to all the participants from different colleges, institutions, and different universities. In addition, I would also like to say that Department of Commerce is planning to organize such a number of webinars in the coming months and weeks. And for this, I request all the participants to please fill the Google form, the feedback form that is given to you. And with this, I am thankful to all of you. Thank you, Pooja ji, again.
Thanks. Thank you very much. A big thanks to, I am also grateful to Commerce Department and to Commerce Association for making me part of this webinar series. I'm so glad and so grateful to my college and to Commerce Association for making me part of this webinar series. I have also learned a lot out of this. A big thanks to my dear friend Aarti for making me part of this. A big thank you to all the participants for being so patient and for being so encouraging. It is a great, great encouragement for me for asking me to hold these webinars in series. Thanks a ton.
Thank you all. So I think we can end the meeting over here.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you.